Excellent. Budget presentation. Mary June, assuming that's you.
It's interesting to hear the commentaries about the curriculum information coming out so late from the state, because today I received an email telling me that the folks responsible for the employee retirement system have not really come out with the sliding rate that we would be looking at for the pension smoothing. They haven't updated their information since 2011. So while we have school boards that are trying to make decisions on these things, we don't have updated information yet. I expect, hopefully, we would get it before July 1st, but you never can tell. So it seems to be a pandemic within the state education departments. I offer to you some review of some of the questions I've been asking for some time. And so I went back into the previous presentations for the year as I was putting together this presentation. And in October, I asked about these questions. We currently don't have 4% in the unassigned fund balance. Depending on what we do at the in your decisions relative to how much money we will appropriate into the revenue stream this year, I may be able to refill that unassigned fund balance to the 4% that we're allowed to maintain there. And I asked about committing a set percentage of the budget for appropriation into the revenue stream each year. That was a recommendation of our internal auditor a couple of years ago. We haven't done that. The difficult thing with being all over the page and how much money we appropriate into the revenue stream is that we create, by necessity, a funding cliff. As soon as we don't have more money to put into that revenue stream, or we don't have as much money to put into that revenue stream in a subsequent year, then we have a funding cliff and it's going to impact the taxpayer. If you have a committed percentage into the budget, then of course there are ways that we'll build it into the budget. We can even build it in just on a straight budget line. But it's something that was recommended that we be conscious of and aware of. So that was some of the October questions. I guess you have to control me. In November, I was suggesting that we might have a $3.1 million gap. That was a very conservative projection based on, compared to what we have now, the information we have available now. But I started talking to you about what would be a reasonable tax rate increase. Again, and I'm going to say this over and over again, other schools don't look at it that way. The board is not voting on the tax rate right now, today, and neither is the public voting on the tax rate in May. The board is voting on the budget amount of how much you'll allow us to spend next year, tonight, hopefully, and the public in May will be voting on the budget amount as well, how much they will allow us to spend. In late July, you will tell me to go out and levy a tax such that I can bring in a levy amount to help us to fund the budget that we approve in these next couple of months. And then the County Assessment Office typically determines the rate. But we can give you a good projection on what various scenarios might provide us relative to rates. And so that's what we do, and it's been a long-standing practice here in Lansing, so we've honored that in the 5 years I've been here. But I did start asking that question back then, and given the district current dynamics, and by those dynamics talking about the shortfalls that we see coming with the next two decreases in value for AES, or for the, sorry, the Cayuga Power Plant over the next 2 years will continue to decrease in value according to the pilot agreement, and state aid being somewhat frozen at that time, at least in November, considering that it would be frozen, started to ask these questions. Also in November, at the second meeting in November, I asked again about are you interested in maintaining the 4% fund balance, discussion about a set percentage of the budget for appropriation into the revenue stream each year, and then asked the question about formalizing the board's intended request for a program budget. Since then, the superintendent and I have said, it's nice not to say acting superintendent, the superintendent and I have talked about starting to present a really detailed program budget, much more detailed than we had discussed earlier this year, and I'm prepared to start pulling the trigger on that in the next week or so. And we'll start to put together a really detailed program budget for analysis, hopefully with the formation of a budget committee, but for the board as a whole to start to analyze perhaps as soon as late May or June, and we start that analysis now moving into the 14-15 budget preparation, because we know we're looking at a couple of difficult years ahead of us. Questions for the board in December were, again, a reasonable tax rate increase. Given the district's current dynamics, what is an appropriate tax rate increase in the coming years? Just things to look forward and look ahead. And that brought us to January, where I started giving you detailed information about the budget. My techie is a little slow. Oh, see now, are you able to modify that? You know, the first slide didn't change again when you were in my office and I saved the modifications. It didn't. I had a problem today. I don't know why, but every time I modified this presentation and saved it, it didn't save. And so you can't black that out. I can go into my master and black it out. I'll tell you the numbers here. These are numbers that you've seen before. Just to explain this to the public, because I explained it to you in an email last week, doing some analysis last week on the legislative state aid runs, or the legislative state aid information, I was able to do a further analysis. They were projecting about the governor and then the legislature had projected about a $400,000 increase in state aid under the building aid category. That's always a little bit of a slippery slope. Things change as the final cost reports are submitted and the information is analyzed by the state and what are they really going to allow and what aren't they going to allow relative to aidability of those expenditures. So I was able to spend some time last week and really go through their numbers and go through last year's GEN reports on building aid and determined that we will be seeing just about as much money as the state had said. They had said $1.6 million in building aid. I'm projecting about a $1.5 million in building aid. We are losing a little bit of Excel aid that we should have been getting, that we're paying back, actually, a little bit of Excel aid we've been getting the last couple of years because the roof project of 2009 came in so under budget. And we then have to lose that Excel aid. At any rate, so I'm presenting to you a budget now that's about $235,000 more, $235,000 more than the budget I've been presenting to you for the last several months. I've been presenting a $26,300,442, I think, for a budget number, and now I've increased that to $26,536,296. All of that increase is related to the cost of bonding the Learning Health and Safety Project, and all of that cost is offset by state aid, is matched by state aid. So there's no tax impact on this budget increase from $26,300,442 to $26,536,296.
Which numbers are?
So, once again, I've been presenting these to you all along. This is what we had budgeted for 12-13. These are the actual costs as I see them now. We still have a few months to go, clearly, in 12-13. So we had budgeted a $26 million project. We're looking to spend around 24.5, and the new budget total is $26,536,296. And I'll read those numbers to you. I apologize again for that not having changed. So general support is what you see there. The instructional total for a 13-14 budget is $12,976,985. And each year as a percentage of the budget for 12-13, that was 49.23%. Moving into 13-14, it's 48.90%. We'll fix this for the website. The pupil transportation number for the 13-14 budget is $1,002,296. As a percentage of the budget in 12-13, pupil transportation consumed 3.79% of the budget. Looking at next year, we're suggesting it'll consume 3.78% of the budget. Undistributed expenditures, which is employee benefits and all of the capital aid, or I'm sorry, the capital debt. For 2013-14, it is increasing to $9,369,065. And it's actually reducing as a percentage of the total budget from 35.39% in 12-13 to 35.31% in 13-14. That reduction is primarily a result, even though the capital expenditures are going to be increasing for the bond payment, the reduction is primarily the result of decreasing health care costs.
So Mary Jo, can you go back to on the same slide, but you're saying that the increase from the roughly $200,000 increase, right? Because you're talking about 26.3 last couple meetings. Now you're saying 26.5-ish for the budget, but you're saying that is due to A bond? Can you say it again?
So the learning, when we went out for the Learning Health and Safety Project, which was the summer of 2011, mostly, we're still, we just, I just did the closing documents on that project last week, we've had some trouble with one of the vendors, one of the contractors on that particular project, getting things done. So when we first went out and started that project, we had to pay for it while it was happening. We paid for it with a good portion of capital reserve that we had put aside for that reason. And then we took out a bond anticipation note, which is a ban. I call it a ban in my communications with you. We took out a ban to pay for the rest of the project. That bond anticipation note comes due each year. And each year we renew that bond anticipation note and we only pay the interest on it. Each year of this particular ban that we took out for this project, the interest was around $9,500. We paid that interest out of our debt service fund. Okay? So in June of this year, we are expecting to, instead of redoing that ban with another year-long ban, we are bonding the project. So we're going into the formal payment for that project. Okay? And that'll be a long-term bond, a long-term debt, 15-year debt. We'll have an annual principal to pay on that debt, and we will have two annual interest payments on that debt. The sum of those payments, they come into play at this time. We schedule all of this with the financial advisors, and we schedule it this way because we want to schedule that the bond payment is going to start happening when we start receiving state aid on the project.
Okay.
And the whole point of doing that is to minimize the local impact of that project.
Mary June, essentially this is akin to a construction loan until you finish your project and then you go into a full mortgage or whatever.
Exactly.
That's what the ban is, essentially.
Yep.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. This is the other version of the budget I always have to credit to Dave Klum because he created this version for me and I use the spreadsheet year after year after year. He deserves credit for it. So this just breaks it up instead of the four categories defined by the state that you saw on the previous slide. This breaks the budgets up by these categories because I think there was some interest here in seeing just how much do we pay in salaries and specifically how much do we pay in benefits and specifically how much do we pay in BOCES and things of that nature. And so this just brings out again the 2013-14. You have again the budgeted in the first column for 12-13, how much it looks like we will actually spend in each of those categories for 12-13, and then the budgeted amount for 2013-14. And again, the dollar amounts for the entire budgets are the same at the bottom, across the bottom. I broke them out as a percentage of the budget each year, just to see. You can see salaries are increasing as a percentage of the budget. Non-salary expenditures are decreasing. BOCES is increasing. We've talked about that a lot in recent weeks. The superintendent and I agree that consolidation of services is a good way to go. Most BOCES services that we purchase, we receive BOCES aid on. So the first year it costs us more to do that typically to go into a BOCES service, but by the second year we start to receive that aid and the net cost becomes significantly smaller. Benefits reducing again, primarily setting right some of that health insurance payment and the reduction in health insurance costs related to the agreement with the Teachers Association. And then debt service increasing, and again that debt service increase is matched by, offset by state aid. Matching those dollars. This breaks down what the drivers are in this year's budget. And I really took the drivers based on what they are in this year's budget. And so in that first column, you're looking at the 12-13 budget again, 12-13 actual in the second column, 13-14 budget in the third column. And then you see the dollar change, and that dollar change is from the 12-13 budget to the 13-14 budget. I think I've described enough for you why it is we are able to underspend these categories in some years. Some years you'll see these under expenditures in greater numbers in different categories than other years. I've done a fund balance analysis for you every year. I'll continue to do that. And I do that out of curiosity for myself. It helps me to better plan the budget. Typically, when we see ourselves underspending budget categories, I look for them in utilities because we've done so much to save money in our utility expenditures, and in special education. Again, I've said it repeatedly. We need to budget for special education needs that we've experienced in the past. And if we don't realize those needs, then that money becomes available to roll into the next year's budget. So you can see the significant changes. Our salaries increasing budget to budget by about $330,000. That's primarily, I see those in athletics. We added some coaching staff last year, I think, during the course of the budget. And so that translated into this year a little bit late. And so as I'm projecting it into the 13-14 budget, it's the first year those additional salaries are being projected into the budget itself. School psychologists, we took out of a federal fund financing. We're trying to move more money out of federal fund financing. Let me rephrase that and make it a little clearer, perhaps. We received grants from the federal and state government. We used to use most of the monies in those grants to pay for salaries. I've tried to move away from that. The danger in doing that is that if those grants dry up, if the federal or the state government take the grant money away, how are you going to pay for those salaries? Presumably, we're not carrying any positions in this district that we don't need for the good of children. So rather than endanger the budget in that manner, what we've been doing is trying to move more of the grant money towards professional development, towards things that we purchase, because we might be able to find ways to squeeze ourselves out of those things before we can find ways to squeeze ourselves out of people. So there's a psychologist that's in the 13-14 budget that you didn't see in the 12-13 budget because they were being paid for under a federal grant, so in a different budget code. And some special education salaries. There were just some increases in there. Again, probably movements moving people out of grant expenditures. BOCES, this is a result of staffing changes. We're increasing the art itinerant a little bit. The business office reconfiguration that we've spoken about, the last presentation I did talked about that. And we're increasing our computer assistance purchased through the CineRec. Because we will then receive aid on those salaries. And so it's going to cost us a little bit more money in this next year. We've also significantly increased our data needs. The superintendent and I were talking about it, and we'll put some of this together. This is much the result of the mandates of the APPR and all of the new requirements that are coming down the pike on the teachers and principals. And as a result, we've had to hire more and more services from BOCES related to data analysis, data inputting, all of that stuff. We're suggesting it's at least $500,000 that we're spending in excess of what we used to spend related to these new requirements and the data coordination of those requirements. Career and tech prices have gone, or career and tech expenses have gone up. That's just based on our 3-year rolling average of numbers, as was explained to you at the last meeting. And BOCES administration charges have increased year to year. ERS, and this is where we start to get into some of the juicy stuff of the budgets for these last couple of years and next couple of years probably. The mandated increase in the employee retirement system is increasing from 18.9 to 20.9. And the mandated increase in TRS is increasing from 12.5 to 16.25, really. I rounded it up there to 5. So you see what's driving the budget. That leads to those budget drivers alone are increasing our budget need by $890,000. However, our total budget is increasing by $500,000. So there's about $400,000 in there, or $350,000 in there, that are areas that we're cutting because of the fact that we're underspending utilities and benefits and some of those other categories. So I think it's important. I think this was some of what we were looking at last week, and I think that this gives you a little clearer indication of what we're really doing with this budget, not rolling one budget into the next, but rather doing calculations and determining how much money do we need to spend in each year. I have several slides on this, and I was sort of anticipating that you might have a lot of questions on it, because I know that NISBA has been sending out information on it. We do have pretty good information on what's going on with the TRS rate freeze. In my email to you, I included a spreadsheet that was provided to me by the School Business Administrator's website. It's just a professional organization, and we all kind of can communicate with each other on that website. And somebody came up with a great spreadsheet that I've played with a little bit, and if we choose to take a deeper look at the possibility of the TRS or the ERS rate freeze, I would suggest perhaps either the whole board if you prefer, but if it wants to be perhaps a committee of the board, a budget committee if you will, we could come together with that spreadsheet and work with the actual numbers that I have at my disposal. The rub with this is that we're looking at this tonight. Tomorrow is when the New York State Teacher Retirement System Board will get together and discuss this option. My guess is that they will allow the option, but tomorrow is the day that they discuss it, so there's no point in us really making a firm decision tonight. We would have to file that we're going to participate in this option if we choose to participate in it by July 1st of this year in order to participate next year. If we don't sign up this year, we cannot sign up in future years. It's different in that way than the ERS pension smoothing. The stable rate is offered for 6 years, and again, you must sign up this year or never. And the rate for next year would be 14%. So the idea is that for 6 years, they would give a stable TRS rate of 14%. If we go to the next slide, we'll see some of the caveats coming in. TRS is given in the law, is given the option to increase the rate by up to 2% for each time in the third year and again in the fifth year. So in 2015-16, they could increase the rate from 14% to 16%. And then again in 17-18, they can increase the rate from 16% to 18%.
Sorry, Mary June, this is if you don't take the freeze option?
This is if you go in the freeze.
With the freeze.
If you don't take the
with the freeze, they can still increase it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's just a terminology glitch. You get used to that with the state of New York.
And on my right, they're charging a 3% interest.
Right. Yes.
So
yes.
This is similar to tax cap that's not a cap. This is a freeze
that's right.
Not a freeze.
That's right. That's exactly right.
Sounds logical.
Yeah, there's some other ones that hopefully will pop into my head that I've came across in the last couple of weeks, some terminology problems. Deferred employer contribution amount. So in year six, we would have to start producing an amortized payment for the first 5 years. And in year eight, year six and seven would be added on. Over a five-year period, again, that would bring it up to 12 years total. And the interest you can see there is, right now they're suggesting it's around 3%, but it's going to be an average yield of the 10-year treasury bonds as of August 1st of the deferred year, plus 1%.
Okay, 15?
Yes.
So what happens if the rate is actually, if it's lower, you still pay this?
You pay the higher rate.
Higher?
That's right. And if it's higher, you pay this rate. If at any time the New York State TRS decides that the system is not fully funded because of something going on in the market and something going on with their investments, they can end this, and you begin paying back any amount you owe with the amortized interest immediately.
Yeah, I mean, it's you can pay me now or pay me later.
It really is.
Interest, right? Pay me now or pay me later with interest.
Yeah, I know very few school districts that are taking up on it, and I wouldn't recommend it because I don't like to recommend paying interest on anything. You know, if you have the money to buy the car, don't take out a loan for it. You know, the only reason I would think that this board might consider it is because we know that in the 14-15 budget year and the 15-16 budget year, we're looking at more difficult decisions related to our budget and the funding of our budget. And this would reduce those payments for the TRS by around $200,000 in each of those years. I've done it all out on that spreadsheet that I sent to you, and I added some other calculations of my own on that spreadsheet to really look at our assessed values and what the tax impacts would be. And if we went into this and followed it for the full years that we can follow it, and it stays, and I even increased the TRS anticipated accrued rates to what I'm saying they're going to go up to, which may be in the mid-20s, and we would spend an additional around $200,000 over the course of the 12 years.
That's at 3%.
That's with the 3%.
If interest rates go to 9%, you're going to spend a lot more.
Then we're going to spend more.
Right.
Then we're going to spend more. So, you know, it's something that we'll need to talk about. I'll need a decision from you and whether we want to, you know, break out and look at it in more detail or anything, but it really becomes another one of those crystal ball things. And again, it's not a prudent thing from a fiscal perspective to take on an interest when you don't have to.
When do you need a decision on this?
I would need it by July 1, so we have time to discuss this. So here's the impact. If you decided to do this next year, I would be able to reduce the budget by about $200,000 for next year. What I'm encouraging you to consider is that if it was after the public vote on the budget and you decided, hey, you know, let's go ahead and give this a shot, and so we did that, then what we would really be able to do is modify the levy when we go out to the levy vote in late July, or modify the appropriated fund balance, which we know we're going to have to appropriate some fund balance. So we would modify other revenue streams rather than the budget amount. And then we would just underspend the budget by that dollar amount.
So what is the is this something our financial advisor would work with you? And
They don't usually work with us on these types of things. Okay. They really are much more long-term investments and bonding and capital projects. But I know for a fact that they would say, don't do anything that you accrue interest on. Mm-hmm. You know, if you have the money to pay the bill today, don't take out a loan to pay the bill. That's just bad finance.
Mary June, did I understand you said if the rates do go significantly higher, they can come back and basically throw the agreement away?
Yeah. That's right.
So if from our perspective, if it's to their favor, we keep paying, and if it's against their favor, we pay either way, right?
Yeah, pretty much. I think that what they would probably do, if the rates go up to the 25% that the actuarial was telling us about at the retreat I attended in December, if the rates go up into the mid-20s in the next couple of years, I think they'll take it to 18%, and they probably wouldn't go much higher unless there's enough retirees that they're having to pay out that the balance of the fund itself starts to look like it's in trouble.
Well, if you think about it, if you think about this, it's apparent that they're investing this in long-term bonds at 3%. So they're offering you 3%, which is the loss of investment that you would have. Now, if they're investing in long-term bonds, you got to ask, who's their investment advisor? Okay, because right now long-term bonds are at the lowest possible rate. Okay, they're only going to go up. So why would we borrow when they have a built-in inflator on the 10-year Treasury bond? It's going to go up. As the Treasury bonds go up, they'll have more money to pay to retirees. So now you've borrowed, you're going to pay a higher interest so you can pay those retirees. You're going to pay it twice, okay? As opposed to if you don't borrow and the interest rates go up, they're going to need less money because they apparently have tied into the long-term interest rate. So as they need less money because they have more income coming in, we're better off to pay as you go because we're not tied into that interest rate. So right now, if I were doing this, I would bet against the long-term interest rates staying low because they just can't stay at this unusually low rate forever. And so I wouldn't take a bet that they're going to stay low because the downside is, for them to change on us, the downside is way too risky, and we're better off hoping they go up.
So from the sounds of it, I can probably skip by these next couple of slides pretty quickly, which is fine by me. There's a little bit, the one, if it falls below 80%, the stable contribution plan can be terminated by TRS. We may opt out of it at any time, but then we immediately resume our regular payment and begin paying anything that we have deferred. The next slide is some of the assumptions that are attached to the slide that's a spreadsheet, if you will. Assumptions with that slide are that the current rate, employer contribution rate, would remain at 16.25%. I just don't think that's going to happen. The last time that actuarial, I saw him speak at the NASASBO conference up in Saratoga a few years ago. He assured us that the fund was so fully funded to 104% that we wouldn't see rates increase. Mm-hmm. And then, like 2 years later, the rates started going up dramatically. So I don't know, when he tells me in December that they're going to go up to 20 in the mid-20s, he's the actuarial. He's not the investment guy. So I'm not sure, really, how you want to take that information. That is the information I had. At any rate, we can, so there's some assumptions I made, and the table on the next shows that it's a pretty denying decision either way. But again, those assumptions would have to be modified significantly, I think, to be realistic, and that's what I've done on the spreadsheet itself that I worked with today. And that's where I, modifying those assumptions to be a little more realistic in my mind. And I'm telling you that over the course of this opportunity, if we were to take it, it would cost us an additional about $200,000, $230,000, something like that. The ERS rate freeze option, this is also called pension smoothing. They sort of use the terms interchangeably for the two options, although they're managed by different organizations. This is a graded contribution rate, would be 12%. The information I got today, said that the chart that I've been working off of that says the graded contribution rate will increase 1% per year, the information we got today said no, they're actually talking about increasing 0.5% per year. So, you know, it's only as good as the information we get, and we typically get it late. So I don't know that we need to go into this in too much detail. The savings related to this, if we were to opt into it, you know, crunching the numbers on the spreadsheets, I actually saw where if we were to in 14-15 engage in this and do it 14-15, 15-16, 16-17, do it for 3 years, opt into this and then opt back through it, that it would cost us a net of around $11,000 in interest over the course of the life of this. And the assumptions aren't quite as naive, I think, in this particular spreadsheet as they are in the TRS spreadsheet. The employee benefits accrued liability reserve, once again this year, I think it's a third year in a row, perhaps a fourth year in a row, that the state has come out and said, if you want to dip into this reserve, we're going to allow you to because we know you school districts are sitting on all that money and you're hiding it all in this reserve. We're not, I don't believe, as I indicated to you in the email describing this, we are not overfunded in that reserve. We could probably stand to pull perhaps $200,000, maybe $300,000 out of that reserve, maybe $250,000 out of that reserve if we wanted to apply it. My guess is that they're going to continue to offer this option next year, although I can't assure you that my crystal ball is really good. But my guess is that next year might be a better time for us to do it, although if you wanted to be ahead of it, just in case they didn't offer it next year, we might want to pull some money out of that this year, even if we just use it to you know, reduce our appropriated fund balance, or perhaps to bring our unassigned fund balance up to the 4%, or perhaps put it in the capital reserve where we have nothing after we get into this project.
That may be the prudent thing to do, right?
That would reserve be my recommendation.
Reduce it to what we think is appropriate when we have the option this year, and just not spend more money, but just leave the money in the account where we can access it without restrictions. Right?
Yeah.
And what do you think would be a good amount? Like you mentioned, 250. Would half of that? I mean, again, what do we think?
We have about 400,000 in that. Mm-hmm. We can only use that for accrued benefits, so vacation time, sick time that employees have accrued that we pay them for. We don't have a lot of those situations. The retirement incentives for our two major contracts do pay off an incentive based on accrued sick time. The external auditor in the past has allowed me to use this fund to pay off the retirement benefits to the LFA folks who are retiring. They have not allowed me to pay it off to the LSSA folks who are retiring. It seems to me, you know, and I like things to be black and white, that's a lot of gray stuff in there, and it seems to me that they're both the same shade of gray, but I'm being told I can use one and not the other. So I did call the Office of the State Comptroller today. We do have to work through them to have them let us know how much they think it's overfunded. So they essentially have to give us permission to draw that money unless we just use it for these retirement incentives. But I think it would be prudent to put it somewhere else in case the state doesn't offer us this option next year. And it won't be a lot of money, but it'll be something. So I'll see what they give me, and then I'll bring a recommendation to you on doing a transfer of monies from that reserve.
Of doing that, it just increases our flexibility.
I think so.
For future years.
You can always add money to this, but it's very difficult to get the money out of it. This is one of those reserves that's difficult to pull from.
Thinking about future years where we may be tighter.
Yeah.
And do you have an idea how much we? I mean, I know you do, but maybe not right on in your head now. But how much we typically spend here? Any given year, so what we might be able to think about pulling?
It's completely varied, but what I'll do is an analysis of next year and perhaps the next year of what I, you know, I have my projected retirements charts. They're not always right on because people choose to retire later. But I do have some charts out that I'll put together some numbers for next year and the next year and share that with you.
Okay, thank you.
And then we can consider that. You know, the other thing is once we've spent out this reserve, you know, then I'll start bringing those charts to you as part of the budget process, and saying we anticipate these retirements next year at this expense, and we'll include it as a budget line.
Mary June, just how old is this money? When did we fund this, or was it one of those things that we always put, you know, 20 grand a year in year after year? Or?
This used to be a liability, even though it says it's a liability reserve. It used to just be a liability. And when I first started, the state comptroller was here in the district, and they said, oh, you have all this money in this liability that you're not allowed to have. And this is what school districts are doing, and that was how we were sitting on lots of money. And so we took all the money out of the liability, and we said, okay, and we funded all of our reserves. That we had no reserves when I first came here. We created we had a capital reserve that existed, but there was no money in it. We put some money in that. We created the ERS reserve. We created the unemployment reserve, and we put about $400,000, a little over $400,000 in this reserve. I used some money out of this last year, to pay for some retirement incentives, but I think it'll take us a long time in that manner. To wear this money down. I think you have better ways to use that money in the next 2 years than that way. So we've only had that $400,000, or we had about $500,000 in there for 5 years.
The reality is we should have more money put away for retirement costs, but that's illegal.
That's right. And that's why we did have more money, because everyone interpreted it that
way. Now it's illegal.
But then they changed their mind on that. So I had what about the unknowns, and I think we've already talked about some of that. And the unknown, the big unknown was with the TRS. If we opted in after the budget adoption, what would happen? You know, we can't change the budget after it's been adopted, but we can certainly underspend it. We've done that pretty regularly, and then use those monies in future budgets. So that's really where I was going with that. The ERS and EBLR, I think, are pretty clear cut. So our state aid update. And so I give you the 12-13 update. This I gave you in December, and I'm showing you what happened in 12-13 because I want to reassure you that I'm not completely off the mark when I do these projections. Because the reality is that they're projecting how much state aid they're going to give us next year, but we won't, again, really know that until December of next year. After we've completed this year, I've input the dollars that we really spent this year, and then they're going to go back and say, okay, now you can get this much state aid based on your expenditures. So it's important that you understand that, and I keep saying things are moving targets. Here's one of the big ones. Our foundation aid last year, the governor's projection, legislative projection was a little bit higher. I used the legislative projection, and we actually got a good deal less. And I think I explained this in December. One of the wild cards here between these numbers is, I'm losing the term right now. It's related to our high-cost students. It'll pop back into my head. At any rate, they will show it in the projections as coming in the foundation aid, and then when we actually receive it, we'll receive it in our high-cost aid. So that's just the way that lays out, and I'm going to continue to leave it laid out as per the way they project. Here, BOCES, you can see some differences. The legislature thought they'd give us a couple $100,000 more. I projected that low, thinking we would underspend the BOCES budget, because we typically do. And we actually received a little bit more. So that was a good thing. That was some good money in the bank. That's part of why we have more revenues this year than I had projected originally. Textbook, library, software, hardware, technology aids are all pretty well set. They're based on our student count and don't change too much. Transportation's a little bit of a wild card because for the last few years we've underspent our transportation budget. This year, I'm going to show you on the next slide, I'm projecting we're going to spend closer to all of our transportation budget, but I didn't have a big margin on there. Building aid is, you know, all of building aid is really already accounted for. We will spend all that money. We owe it. It's obligated. That's not cash for us to figure out how we want to spend it. We've already spent it. That's coming in related to debt that we carry. And the high tax aid, we thought we were going to lose that this year. We didn't lose. So the bottom line is that the legislature last year had said in April that we were going to get $6.8 million. I had projected we were going to get $6.35 million, and we actually got $6.48. So I was within about $120,000, and I think that was a pretty close slice when we're talking about a few million.
Governor did pretty good.
Not too bad. Yeah, he did. So the next slide will give you the 13-14 aid breakout. And with some analysis that I had some time finally last week because all the principals went out of town, so I didn't have to have meetings all the time. That's why Mr. Hartz doesn't understand that I didn't have meetings. At any rate, you can see that the legislature increased their pledge for the foundation aid, which we're grateful for. And then I'm just comparing it to the actual aid this year so you can see what kind of increases we're looking at from last year's aid numbers. High private cost aid, they're pretty consistent right across the board. Again, there will be about $800,000 that will move out of the foundation aid into that category. BOCES aid, I'm projecting low on the BOCES aid again because I do project that we're going to underspend it by some, and I count on that because that's also a revenue stream that I have in next year's revenue is the BOCES refund that we will receive usually in October or November. Library, these things are pretty well set just based on student counts again. Transportation aid, I'm reducing what they're estimating we're going to get because we have been underspending the transportation budget. Excuse me. I've spoken to you about the fact that we've been short-staffed down there, and we have a supervisor who's doing the work of two or three people. So we're underspending it thanks to Roger Diedrich. Building aid, I'm just coming in a little shy of what they're projecting. That, again, is based on some of the Excel giveback that I'm anticipating we're going to have. The governor was projecting to take away the high tax aid here because we no longer qualify for it, not in total. The legislature came back and said, nope, hold them harmless, keep that aid coming. So I'm counting on that aid to come in full. So I'm projecting a $7 million total aid this year. The legislature is projecting a $7.4 million. I'm coming in about $400,000 less than them.
The next school year?
This is for 13-14.
Mary June, the BOCES, compared to 12-13, you're projecting about $200,000 low. Is that because 12-13, we will get a refund?
We will get a refund. And also because a lot of the increases that we're looking at going into next year are related to salaries. We only receive BOCES aid on up to $30,000 of their salary. So if it's an employee who makes $60,000, we're going to receive aid on that first $30,000, and then we'll receive some administrative aid on that employee, and the other $30,000 we won't get aid on. So, you know, if they're looking at, you know, they're looking at this based on what I told them last October we think we're going to spend in BOCES, and that was last October. I'm saying that we're spending it differently as I project into next year. Long-term projections, you've seen this a number of times. I've modified them slightly based on my updating of the current budget situation, how much I think we're going to have to actually use out of our reserves. The 12-13 numbers are all good for right now. Still, you know, we may end up using less than this. I like to knock on wood when I say those things, but Dan makes fun of me because I just find, what do I find? For mica or something that I knock on instead of wood, but. thank you. I'm projecting that we need a combined levy of the pilots and the levy, the tax levy of 16.9 this year. That's what we brought in. I'm sorry, that's not a projection. That's what we brought in. That's the tax rate. I'm projecting that we're going to use about $200,000 in our reserves. Our rate increase this year from last year was 3.89%. 13-14 again, and I'm rounding some of these numbers. But projecting the budget that I've shown you so far, I'm projecting we need a combined levy of $17,300,000. That would bring, at the 4.26 that I've been providing you with for some time, that would bring the tax rate in at 2041, and we would be using reserves of 1.265. This difference over what I've been showing you for a while is really based on the increased state aid that we're seeing from the legislature. That's why that tax rate is lower than the $20.60-something cents I've been showing you. And then just projecting out, again, budget projections. I really went through the budgets, added contractual agreements that I was aware of that I could add in. Otherwise, I had to project contractual agreement increases. I did include some energy increases. I might be able to back out some of those. We've landed some good long-term energy costs right now. And projecting combined levy based on freezing state aid at the new amount, the $7 million amount. And so being able to bring these down a little bit. So these are your worst scenario numbers still. But the worst scenario numbers have improved from what the worst scenario numbers I was showing you a month or two ago, which I think is significant. Here we've run out of money. If we've done all that spending down, we've run out of money at this point. But we also have a big reduction in our budget. It doesn't come out to, it doesn't show as big, significant a reduction, but it is a reduction, and that's where we have $1 million falling off our costs.
So Mary June, 13-14, we're at about a $500,000 increase, and part of that is, you said the bond, right? I mean, the $200,000 of that.
Mm-hmm.
So the net budget increase is closer to 300, 350.
Mm-hmm.
you've projected, I know this is very conservative, but you've jumped a million in 14-15 and 1.5 million 15-16. The drivers behind those are mostly salaried base?
Salaries, the pensions, I have increased the pensions in these long-term projections. By 15-16, I've increased the pensions into the mid-20s, 25% for TRS and ERS. That's, TRS is a big hit if we go that high. From 16.25 to 25 is going to take us up several hundred thousand dollars, or maybe close to a million. I do have some energy increases in there. I think I've talked about them. And as I'm looking at our numbers, that we are locked in for our electricity until 2017. So I do think that I might be able to reduce some of the energy increases, although I don't think that they're significant. And we'll continue to look for other energy savings. And salary increases, where I don't know what the salary increase is because we don't have a contract established yet, I do those on a conservative side, which means I project them high.
Okay. One last question, the Cayuga plant. I think you both had a meeting with them. It was probably completely off topic with the euphoria over the gas conversion process, but the current model, so it looks like the plant's going to stay operating because they can't shut it down and get enough energy down into this area.
Mm-hmm.
And it's been, that decision, I think, was made in the last 6 months. Has that changed the prognosis of the value of the plant? Let's say even before they, before we even talk about the gas conversion, from now until 17 when that operates, does that increase the value above $60 million?
I've not increased the value myself. I've left it at $60 million.
I know you haven't, but is there any talk yet of, hey guys, this is looking a little different than near bankruptcy. Is there any opportunity to kind of renegotiate the?
Yeah, I'm confident that the county will, as things settle down on this, where they currently are. You know, they're still kind of in the what if stage on a couple of things, even with the NYSEG deal, and the county will immediately step in and say, let's start renegotiating the pilot. The pilot itself, the existing agreement, ends in 15-16. So at that point, the value of the plant goes, unless a new pilot is created, the plant goes back to the assessed property rolls. So the assessment office will go in, will value the plant separate from a pilot agreement, or they may say, because it's a good business model, hey, let's negotiate a new pilot.
So
I think it's important to say, that even though this affects the school probably the most, it's the county who's responsible for negotiating and overseeing. We talk about it and we want to advocate for on the school district's behalf, but it's really the county's responsibility and the county's thing to do.
They're only 3% of the tax.
If
they, on their current plan for conversion, are they planning to be out of operation any of those years?
We have not been informed that way.
Well, I assume they're going to pull the coal boiler out and put a gas boiler in, so I
they have
assume that during that period of time they're not going to generate electricity.
Boilers.
They have two boilers.
So they're going to convert one of them.
I don't know the plan, but I would think that would be logical.
Mm-hmm.
It goes back to the same argument. If they can't get enough power in the peak periods in this area, they can't. It's going to make the argument they can't shut it down. But just speculation. I don't know.
Yeah. Our agreement was that it wouldn't go below $60 million to be conservative at this point during this next 5 years, and because we were projecting $30 million, $15 million, and zero, so we are now pretty much staying at the lowest being $60 million assessment.
So we're less conservative than we were.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
But still, no realistic.
And I think NYSEG's keeping this running right now. So if NYSEG gets other mechanisms for energy, this could change. But I don't think we're going to see an increase. In this in a while, because NYSEG's really the one that's keeping this open. You know, it's not AES, not Cayuga per se, it's NYSEG. So I don't see a property value increase unless something changes significantly there, and really NYSEG is keeping it running.
Well, the difference is NYSEG will have to bring more power lines in, so they'll have to make an investment, as opposed to their supplier making the investment.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
So if I was NYSEG, I'd like to see this plant convert so I don't have to make that investment.
Yeah. It's definitely really good news, just even as is, as tentative as it may sound. It's very good news for the Lansing taxpayer, I think. So there's your conservative projections, very conservative. Again, just an update on our reserves. What do we have? What are we moving through? I could have tweaked this a little bit more, but this is the one that you have seen. And again, everything is rounded. Again, I don't include the capital reserve. Once there's money in that capital reserve, it can only be used for capital projects and only with the permission of the voters. So in 12-13, where we started the year off, is we have about $1.5 million in reserves. We had said we will assign $2 million of that into the revenue stream if we need to. And that left our unassigned fund balance somewhere short of 4% at about $750,000. If we use about $220,000, essentially from there, we'll be left with the $4 million, and then I bring us into the beginning of 13-14. So calling this assigned fund balance is really a misnomer. It should no longer have that name, but that's money that could be available to assign without having to take it out of the unassigned fund balance or the reserves. I'm suggesting at that current 4.26% tax rate increase that I've been presenting to you since December, I'm suggesting that we would use maybe 1.265, you know, that's the number that rounds it out for us. And if we used that much, it would leave us about 2.7. 14-15, we would just continue to follow through. You saw this on an earlier slide where I projected we might appropriate 1.8 million of what was left, and that would leave us with almost a million to move into the 15-16 year, and then leave us without any reserves or any dollars in the pocket whatsoever in 16-17. Again, conservative. If we can underspend the budget in 13-14 like we have in these years, I don't think it'll be as much, but you know, every year I walk out of the budget process saying we are so tight, I don't know how we're going to make it, and then we find ways. Some of it, people find it for us, they don't come into work, but some of it is just things that we find that we save money. The faculty and staff overwhelmingly in this district have been outstanding for the last 5 years since I've been here, and just saying, you know, really, do I need it? Is this really what kids need? And I think they've done a great job of tightening their belt all over the place.
Mary June, the 250 we talked about pulling out of the E-bar, is that in here? E-baller. Yeah,
that is in there. The whole thing is in there. The whole E-baller is in here.
So E-baller is gone in 2016-17?
Well, this is just, you know, what could we do to try to make ends meet as we continue to have a reduction in AES, a reduction in AES, a reduction, I'm sorry, in Cayuga Power Plant each of those years. So
the E-baller is in it?
Yes. Everything's in there except capital project reserve.
Oh, okay. So then the assigned fund balance is what we underspent, right, from the budget? What that line is?
No, that's how much money we said we would inject into the revenue stream if we needed it to make the budget whole. So we said we have a $26 million budget. We were getting about $24 million between state aid and taxes and those miscellaneous things we projected. So we said, okay, we'll put $2 million into that stream.
So where is the money that's actually underspent? Where is that?
Well, this is a these are revenue, sort of. This is reserves. So you see it here. The difference between this and this is how much we're underspending. Not completely how much we're underspending. The difference between this and this is how much we're underspending and the areas that we've gotten excess revenue.
Say that again.
No.
$1.8 million.
No, what did we appropriate? We used $220, but we appropriated $1 million something, right?
No, we said we would appropriate $2
million.
Going into this year, we said we would appropriate $2
million. At the budget.
A year ago.
Right. What is
in order to bring the budget in where you were directing us to, we said, okay, you know, we've done all the cutting we're going to do, and the public was a little bit up in arms about some of those cuts. And Dr. Grimm said, okay, appropriate the rest. And so we said we will appropriate $2 million from our dollars, our bank account, we will appropriate $2 million into the revenue stream. Because we're underspending the budget this year, right now, by about 1.5, and because we've garnered some excess revenues in a few categories, we sold some more scrap metal, you know, another pilot came in that we weren't aware of, things like that, we actually are only going to need to use $220,000 right now. I mean, we keep going through this year.
So instead of
nothing
$2
goes
million,
bad, instead then
of, instead of $2 million, we actually only used
220. And maybe less, maybe more.
Those
I mean, we're not done with
those
the
those are reserves. That's not appropriated into the budget. That's your reserves. You can see the budget. You can see the reserve going down by 22 in the next period, and the reserve starting to get used. We're in the wrong slide. You got to get into your revenue and expense side. This is an asset slide.
Sure.
Your asset.
That's my, this
shouldn't be confusing, so if I've confused you, let me help you.
No, no, you didn't confuse me, but I just don't, I can't follow, okay, so we asked for $26 million last year. We only spent $24 million this year.
24 and a half.
Just saying, okay. So where is that $2 million? How do you follow it through this? That's what I'm having trouble with.
Okay, so what's the difference between this and this?
$220.
Between this number and this number, it's $220. So we have 1.8, if we only spend $220,000 out of this dollar amount that we said we were going to assign, okay, if we only spend $228,000, then I really have $1.8 million there that's not sitting in a reserve, that's not part of our unassigned, it's where it should be, and that's where the accountants will put it at the end of the year. But I have $1.8 million there that I'm saying this is not spoken for, and we can use any of these dollars again next year. And I'm suggesting if we were to use this amount.
Okay, So, this is where I get confused. Can you hear me? So, this is why I get confused and I can't follow where this part of money goes. So are you saying at the end of 2011, 2012, we had $2,047,000 left that was not spent in the budget?
That's right. That's not the right way to say it.
Okay. So, that's why I'm looking for the money that was not spent in the budget. Like you said, we're going to spend.
Well, you're not going to see it on this slide because you're talking about an expenditure.
Yeah.
So you need to look at a budget slide.
Okay.
We have budget, and we have the dollars to pay for the budget.
All right. So
this has to do with the dollars
so
to pay for the budget.
That money that we have not spent, the $2 million we haven't spent, is nowhere on this slide.
Right.
Yes. Right.
Okay.
Sort of.
And even from previous years.
This is all the money we have.
Those are balances.
This is all the money we have that's not part of our current budget activity.
It's not. No.
Right.
This right here.
Right.
Okay?
Okay.
This could become part of our current budget activity. I'm saying we're only going to put this much in our current budget activity. Of that $2 million, we're going to put this much.
Okay. I guess for me, it'd be nice to see if, you know,
let's make some time and we'll get together and you can go through the numbers with you and you can show me how you want me to lay it out.
We can, but I'm just saying this, you know, like if we say we're gonna ask for $26 million and we say we only spent $24 million, like it'd be nice to kind of see where that $2 million goes. And we can talk about that more later, but and I'm just saying that so maybe other people
I think
might
I
wanna hear that.
Where it goes.
I don't know where.
Where it goes right into this account. Right? This is the balance. It goes right into the balance.
You're talking again about how we didn't spend that money. Is that right?
No.
And that's the presentation I give whenever I give the fund balance analysis and what I did earlier. And I talk about what did we underspend? We underspent some salaries.
Right.
Okay?
Right.
Okay. So so you want to see more detail on the dollars we didn't on each of the budget codes that were underspent and why?
No, not more details. But if we underspent $2 million last year, how does that $2 million affect this or whatever dollars we're assigning? Like I'm looking
it means we're going to use less of this than we said.
Right, but
we're going to use this much of it.
I just think it'd be nice to kind of see that in the slide. And we can talk about, we can talk about that later. I think it'd be nice to see on the slide if we save $2 million, how is that $2 million that we saved or actually where is that flow in these slides? I think that'd be nice to see community person too. So
I think I'll need to sit with you though to understand that to make sure I'm making it clear because I understand that I'm not making it clear and I apologize for that.
It would probably be good to have comparative income statements, revenue and expense slides so you could see it. Because you got what the top part is your fund balances, so that's a stock. What you're looking at down here is what your anticipated outflows from those fund balances are.
To support the budget.
But it doesn't have the accompanying expenditures that puts it in perspective, you know.
The prior slides had that budget. No, the prior slides had what those budget, what you're going to spend.
The prior slides had it for the budget.
It's all here.
But it didn't have it has it for 2013-14, but not, there was a slide last time that had 2012-13, but not this time. Because I just went back and looked through them, and I can't.
Those are the slides that have one column for what was the budget for 12-13, one column for what's actually going to be spent in 12-13, and one column for what am I projecting for 13-14.
That's right. No, we have projections. We have total.
And you have the current.
But we don't have one that's got the use of appropriated fund balances in it as a source of revenue. That one we don't have, where we could look at it to see the change. Unless I'm missing
the slide here. I'm confused, so I apologize.
I'm really happy to come in at that time.
That would be great.
Yeah, I think what you're saying is this line is really a revenue line that supports the budget.
That's the actual amount of revenue we took out of one of those fund balances for this year.
That's the outflow.
So that's the amount that's in the income statement,
yes.
Okay? And those are the resulting fund balances for the changes. So we're talking about the change in one account, okay, the unassigned fund balance, as we're looking at the amount used in fiscal year, and we see it going down by exactly that amount.
These are all savings accounts.
But we're not getting into perspective as to what percentage of the budget is, or what we had anticipated it was going to be, and you know,
I don't think we anticipate the budget and the revenue in the same breath. They're different activities.
Yeah. This is all our savings accounts.
Well,
the revenue is what supports the budget.
You know.
Yeah.
Supposedly, if you don't have the revenue, you can't have the expenditure budget. So, having them side by side, it kind of since
the revenues have nothing to do with the actual expenditures. They're two different activities.
Well,
you
don't get to have the expenditures unless you have the revenue.
And that's because the projection piece.
Yeah, that's right.
But in the actual practice, the revenues aren't going to dry up because we're not spending it, with the exception of the money that we projected.
Exactly. The revenues flow, okay? And if you underspend it, you have excess revenues. But if you overspend it, you got to go up here and find some more money.
And that's really our issue, is we're spending more than we have, and we're using our savings account.
And that's it right there, the savings account. But we just have that line. We don't have the budget. See how it's being used.
I understand. Because this is
probably clear because other people probably don't.
This is looking at our long-term projection of that savings account if we continue spending more than we're bringing in, right?
Right.
Exactly.
And the difference from reality is that we're usually significantly overperforming on that balance. You've projected it very conservatively, and by 2015, it's zero. If you look at our past trend, that's unlikely to happen. We can't guarantee it, right? Mm-hmm. And this is a conservative approach. But this looks worse than likely it's going to be. But we still have to make decisions year by year on what we think we can spend and how much we're going to carry over.
If this year you decided to keep the tax rate at a zero increase, we would consume a whole bunch of this money.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Or we'd have to turn around and in the next couple of days, we'd have to slice a couple million dollars off of the budget.
Right.
Or we say we want a 10%.
Then we won't consume so much of this.
Right.
Yeah. Sorry about that. We'll work on it as easy, you and I. So budget funding options. These were the three options I provided you initially, and I did do a slide with more. Julie asked for some more options, so I did a slide with more. The reason I provided you with these three is a 3.99% increase based on some of the conversation at the last meeting. I think the superintendent said to me, show us what a 3.99% increase looks like. If you'll notice, the state aid doesn't change. The federal aid doesn't change. I'm hopeful we'll get that much, but it's not enough money to worry about too much. The miscellaneous doesn't change. The only things that are going to change are the things that are impacted by the tax rate, which is pilots and property tax levy, and how much money we have to appropriate from our savings account in order to make the budget float. And so at a 3.99%, the impact on a $200,000 home would be $306 a year. Our combined levy would be the combination of those numbers. Somebody can add that up for me if they want. And we would have to appropriate 1.311. The 4.26 is the percent I've been showing you for a long time. The impact on a $200,000 home is a $317 bill per year. That's additional. That's additional to what they're currently paying. And I gave you a 5.18% tax rate increase because this is the maximum amount we could get under the tax cap, under the property tax cap. We can actually, in the current calculation, and it changes the second we change the percentage rate that we're going to go out for, because the change in the percentage tax rate that we're going to go out for is going to modify the pilots, and when I modify the pilots, I modify the tax cap. It's just all part of how that formula works. So So I have to enter this backwards because of our pilots, our significant pilots. Right now, when I do the calculations at around these numbers, it gives me a property tax cap for the tax levy of $15,705. I'm sorry, $15,705,000 and some dollars. So this is about as close as I can get, so it's a 5.8% tax rate increase would be the property tax cap.
Okay. So if you move from a 3.99 to a 5.18, you can basically keep in your unappropriated fund balance or your appropriated fund balance $200,000.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. That's basically the difference. You raise the tax rate by, you know, 1%, a little over 1.2% about, and you save $200,000. So in the long run, that $200,000 isn't going to do much for you.
From last year, that's consistent. We've said about 1% is good for about, what, 110 to 130?
Yep.
Something like that.
But I mean, you know, it's not like we're still not facing the same problem that we have in 2017, whether we save $200,000 now.
The problem
or
doesn't
not
go away.
Right.
Can I ask a question? So for the first column, if the tax rate is 3.99%, we can maintain program and staff and everything that's...
Yeah, all of these are with our current, current program. No increases, and never really looking at increasing, so it's just maintaining.
These are just different ways to support a $26,500,000 $1,000 budget.
So it's... So we use 200,000 from, as you mentioned, from left to right, we're using $200,000 less of the savings account.
I think our what we got to ask ourselves is it worthwhile raising your tax rate 1.2% to save $200,000 in your fund balance,
which is a pretty small percentage of our budget.
That's right. But then I don't think it's worth it.
What's it look like years to come is my big concern. Yeah. So I know it's not probably what some of the public wants to hear, but 200,000 is 200,000 compared to what if we don't do this, and then what are we looking at years and years to come, and now we don't have the appropriate money. Or
it's 200,000, but it's compounding. It's cumulative, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that 200,000 is there next year, and for the same decision is another 200,000. So come 17, could you go back two slides if you don't mind real quick?
Mm-hmm.
No, right here.
No.
So do you, I'm sorry, yeah, no, I guess this is it. What do the projections look like for an increase now that we have zero fund balance? So if you project out what we think the budget is gonna be, even if it's flat or boosted half a million because that's on the low side.
So we start to see that here. And this is a real big jump here. Well, here is a big jump too. But this is a big jump here. Some of that's related to the budget increase, but some of this is also related to the fact that we've got a funding cliff now with our reserves.
Right.
And it's the same funding cliff we've had with the Cayuga Power Plant. It's the same funding cliff we've had with the federal funding that came in 2009 and has disappeared now and started off at $1.3 million and slowly receded over for a few $100,000 a year. And every year, that was impacting our tax rate.
Could you explain again why in the 16-17, although we have the $1 million cliff, where that's coming from, the payoff, how we're losing that payment?
Capital projects. So we had back in 2003, the district combined a bunch of its existing debt to get a lower interest rate on all of that debt, and it went out for about a $15 million bond. And we have a significant portion payment on that bond, $1 million principal payment falling off as we move into this year. So it goes from $1.25 million for that one bond payment to $250,000 that year. One of the things we've been discussing for the last several years is, boy, that'll be great when that falls out because we'll be able to use it as an investment in the facilities. It'll be a major capital project, and some of the stuff that we're, you know, Glenn Fenner is holding together with duct tape right now, we'll be able to get that fixed. But I'm showing it as we're taking that money out of the budget.
And that's, you know, I'm sure you'll agree, that's very unrealistic because we're broke and
it's
we have
dangerous.
No money put aside for anything in the future. If we try and put anything back into even half of the funding, we're going to be adding at least 5% to that just to get whole.
In right? 2 to 3 years, we have to finance either a connection to a sewer, a town sewer, mm-hmm. or new septics.
Right.
And it's going to cost us a bunch of money to do that.
Right.
And if we don't have some money put aside, we don't have a very high aid rate on our building, so we're going to have to pay out of the taxpayer's pocket for 45% of that work.
So a realistic mm-hmm. tax rate out there is another 12%.
Yes.
So other than the built-in conservatism and looking for continued opportunities to cut $500,000 to $1 million a year, this is going to be our reality, right?
That will be our reality, yep. And this doesn't account for the need to do more capital projects.
Yeah, I'm kind of already projecting that that's 12 rather than 3.5 because it has to be.
Mm-hmm. And then with the tax cap, we'd have to get more than 50% of the individuals coming forth to pass this kind of budget.
More than 60.
Oh, yeah, 60.
More than 60. If you go forward a few slides, I'll show you another projection, and not to confuse things more. So these are the three I provided you. This is the slide you've seen for a while to show you where the Lansing taxpayers are relative to the rest of the taxpayers in Tompkins County as far as who has the highest school district tax rates. And then the next slide is, so Julie had written and just said, can you give us some other scenarios? And I think last time I suggested a 4.79. So she sort of played on that based on her discussion with the community and said, give me a 3.79, the 4.79, increase it a percentage and increase it another percentage. And so that's what I sort of played with here. And
we just scroll down a little bit more.
How would we fund these things, yeah, and what would that enable us to do, and okay. what would it look like on an individual
so
home?
Really, the thought is, in those out years, it may be difficult to exceed the cap.
Mm-hmm.
But if we do it gradually, then we don't face the cap as a dramatic
and a negative vote.
As painful as it is mm-hmm. now, right?
That's my thoughts.
Yeah.
And the cap, again, would take you somewhere in between here.
Yeah,
sorry
in between
to interrupt
there,
somebody.
Yeah, I have a question, but it's going to go back to Aziza's question, then I'll come with her. But, all right, so when we underspend the budget like we did, which is good that we saved the money,
mm-hmm.
where do those savings go? Do they go into reserves, or where does it go?
Right now, they're just sitting there in that assigned fund balance. Part of the shell game, just because the law has different parameters of where money has to be sitting, if we are not committing to appropriate all that money into next year's budget stream, then I'm going to have to move some into that unassigned 4% that we can get up to 4%. And if there's some left over, I think our getting us up to 4% is still about a little over $1 million. And if there's still some left over, we'll need to move it into one of our reserves. We do have a couple of reserves that are pretty easy flow, pretty nebulous borders that you can make decisions just as a board to, you know, move money into the unemployment reserve or out of the unemployment reserve. Same with the ERS reserve. Those are the two that, you know, we only have a couple thousand dollars in each, but.
I think really we never have any money left over. We're just using
less of our savings.
Savings. Yeah.
If we were a balanced budget and had money left over, then we'd have to think about where to put that money.
Uh-huh.
But since we're not in that case, we're in a deficit budget, we just are spending less of our savings account.
So
that
you
makes sense.
You tell your son that you're going to give him $10,000 for living expenses next year at college. And he comes home at the end of the year and he says, Mom, I spent $8,000. What do you do with that extra $2,000? It's for next year.
He doesn't take it and buy a new car or something, right? You
know?
Or
so you're just not using your savings.
Alternatively, your budget lets him have $10,000. He comes home and tells you it's going to cost $15,000.
Well, that's
much more like what we got here.
Yeah.
Tonight, I really needed an approval of the budget amount, if you will. But with that, because of the publication and because we put the tax rate information out there, I need you to consider where you're willing to come in that tax rate so that I can prepare the publication for Debbie to send off.
Does our superintendent and Mary June and others have a recommendation for us to consider, or are you
Well, now that the acting